The Adventurer's Bond. Book 5 of The Adventures on Broad. Written by Tao Wong. Narrated by Eric Martin. Chapter 1. The party of 5 adventurers traversed the first level of Aramis, one of Silverstone's 3 dungeons, carefully, heads swiveling in slow order as they checked their surroundings. The 6-foot-wide walkway of stone they walked upon joined one magically levitated platform to another, crossing empty space at a stomach-churning height. Below, wisps of mist hid and revealed additional platforms and walkways beneath them. On occasion, the screech of an imp or the low chittering sounds of their conversation floated upward to the party. A stout figure in simple brown and green leather moved at the head of the group, bow held in one hand and a trio of arrows in the other. Occasionally, the figure would stop and crouch low as it stared at the ground before rising and moving forward again with a small wave of their hand. Brown hair, shorn short and rough along the skull, framed a pair of liquid brown eyes, a slightly curved nose, and thin lips. A small scar bisected one eyebrow, giving the teenage ranger a more sinister air.
"We will not clear this floor at this rate," rumbled Omrak, the large blonde barbarian from the north, as he walked behind the ranger, his massive two-handed sword held in hand and resting on his shoulder. Sheathed alongside his enchanted soft leather tunic was a trio of throwing axes held in place by a simple leather baldric. Along one tree trunk-sized leg, a short sword hung, appearing deceptively small, like a large knife strapped to his thigh. The ranger stiffened slightly before continuing to move at her original slow pace. Daniel rubbed his nose with his shield hand, briefly blocking his view. In his other hand, the rock bow rested lightly, waiting for Daniel to load and fire the specialized weapon as he trudged just behind Omrak. He looked over at the youngster and decided, once again, against requesting the barbarian to speak softer.
"We're here to learn to work together, Omrak, not clear the floor," Daniel consoled the northerner softly. "I'd rather we learn to do so here than in Artos. At least here we know the dangers."
"A good decision,"
the mage who walked directly beside Daniel agreed. He turned sideways, smiling ingratiatingly at Daniel while he waved a ringed hand at their surroundings. Daniel noted once again the surprisingly calloused and scarred pair of hands, a contrast to the refined appearance other mages often showcased. Dark, glistening hair and a beard adorned the mage's head, hair once again slicked back by the waving hand after he finished gesturing.
"Though our companion's speed is low."
"Trap finding,"
Asen, the only catkin member of the 5, said. Her tail waved behind her lazily as she watched the back of the group from her position 10 steps behind, her keen senses having picked up the conversation between the trio. Unlike the heavily armed and armored pair, the catkin had on a light leather brigandine that covered her torso, a short cloak and criss-crossing baldrics of throwing knives across her body. More throwing knives sat on her thighs and upper arms, and a pair of larger knives sat on her hips for close combat.
"But there is only one type of trap on this floor," said Omrak. "We should be seeking battle."
"If you don't quiet and down, I'm sure we'll find some,"
the mage replied with a grimace and turned back to his side of the walkway to scan for trouble.
"I am quiet, Rob,"
Omrak hissed insistently, even going so far as to turn around to glare at the mage. Instead, he met Daniel's placid brown eyes.
"Eyes forward, Omrak, you know better," Daniel said.
The northerner flushed but nodded, swinging back around and hurrying to get back into line, eyeing both the empty skies and the misty clouds below. Eventually, the quintet made their way to a larger, more stable platform where Daniel held a hand up, signaling a stop. "All right, I think that's enough for now." "Thank you, Tula," Daniel said. The ranger bobbed her head slightly, accepting Daniel's words and making him smile slightly. Tula amused him, as the young lady was a happy, outspoken woman outside the dungeon, but inside, she became as quiet and taciturn as Austin. "It looks like your trap-detecting abilities are slower than Austin's. Maybe it's because they're more suited for the outdoors. Either way, I'd like to adjust our positioning."
"Finally," Omrak grumbled.
Ignoring the blonde, Daniel continued to speak. "Austin, you take the front. Omrak will be behind her, 10 feet back. Tula, you and Rob will be in the middle to provide ranged support. I'll take the back." When he received confirmation from the group about their new formation, Daniel smiled. So far, at least, there had not been any major conflicts of personalities. Luckily, they were all advanced adventurers, and as such, each had some modicum of experience in dungeons. The idiots, the foolhardy hotheads, and those who could not work in teams did not often progress past beginner dungeons. "Let's rest here for 10 minutes, and then we'll try to push for the floor champion." Omrak grinned widely at these words, while the others just nodded in affirmation. As the group spread out to watch one corner of the platform each, they reached for their trail rations, pulling from their inventory water and a simple mixture of nuts, fruits, and dried meat. Daniel noted how Tula, while not having the actual adventurer class, had a skill of her own which allowed her to conveniently store her belongings in the small satchel by her side.
"Enchanted holding?"
Asen asked, her head cocked curiously to the side when she saw Rob pull his rations from a pendant on his chest.
"Yes," Rob said, touching the pendant. "A gift from my master."
There was a hint of warning in his voice, a sign that avarice towards this item would bring significant consequences from an irate master mage.
"Expensive?" Austin said.
"Very much so. Enchanted work like this is in extreme demand because it requires a significant understanding of spatial magic," Rob said. "It is a specialized field and is expensive to develop, more so than other forms of enchanting."
Daniel nodded slowly. He absently wondered if spatial magic was a specialization of a class which would be made available at level 20, or if it was just an area of focus. Of course, he did not ask, as classes could be a touchy subject. The focused, in particular, were touchy about levels. The focused were people like Tula, who had received and stuck to a single class since their age of majority, a choice made when their initial minor class had been given up. This allowed the focused to gain significant levels, since they were not splitting their experience gain across multiple classes. It did, however, reduce the variety of skills they had access to, and made it simpler to grasp their strength if their levels were known. As such, discussing classes and skills in detail were anathema to the focused. In truth, Daniel considered the focused the lucky ones, able to choose a profession when they reached their age of majority, rather than have one forced upon them, like most farmers, miners, and those of the lower classes. Certainly there were focused miners, but they were more often a case of circumstance than choice. They certainly did not go about flaunting their status. Not that Tula or Rob had. Yet. Conversation petered out soon after, the quartet chewing and drinking quickly while allowing their bodies to rest. It was Tula who first noticed the incoming horde, a swarm of 3-foot-tall red-skinned creatures with black claws and web-like wings. Tula let out a low cry of warning as she swiftly stood, her bow in hand and an arrow snatched from the ground where it had been stuck point first.
2 dozen,
Tula reported as she squinted.
She frowned slightly, spotting a much larger imp lagging behind the swarm of red-skinned, black-clawed flying monsters. Swiftly, she drew the string to her cheek and fired, grasping a second arrow immediately, even as the ranger activated her first skill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.